Good morning. Welcome to worship with us at Trucksville United Methodist Church. We are here as a skeleton crew. Dr. Steve is here to provide music. My family's here handling some of the pajama giveaway with Debbie, and then Allison and Sarah are running the technology. Emma's singing. We're trying to keep all of us safe, but still provide an important and meaningful worship service for each of you. A couple announcements. As we say every week, the best way to get a hold of us, the best way to be informed, is to reach out to the church office by email, office@trucksvilleumc.com, or on this Facebook page. We monitor both. We send out prayer requests through email and let you know about other events. I will tell you that on Wednesdays, we continue to have our prayer service at 6:15 in the morning and our Bible study in the evening at 6:30. Those are both Zoom events. The office can get you a link to those if you do not have those. We'll be talking more in the week to come about our Christmas Eve worship opportunities. At this point, we're planning a drive-in service at 4 o'clock. There'll be some logistical emails that go out to talk to you about how and when to come and how we're going to try and process that and put that together. We're going to have a recorded service available at 7 o'clock as well. There may be a few other things. Christmas Day at 10:15, we're going to do our traditional Christmas Day service, but we're going to do it on Zoom. So there'll be a link that goes out for that as well. Again, please let us know how we can help. Let us know how we can stay connected to you through Facebook, through that email address, office@trucksvilleumc.com. Let's do what we have come together separately to do, which is continue our Advent journey and worship Almighty God as we listen to our prelude. Each week as we continue our Advent journey, we've been bringing to you some folks who, while we haven't seen each other in a while, we're trying to bring some familiar faces. This week we're going to hear from Jennifer Dawes as we share the lighting of our Advent wreath this morning.
Today I'm reading from Isaiah chapter 9, verses 2 through 6. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. They lived in the land of shadows, but now light is shining on them. You have given them great joy, Lord. You have made them happy. They rejoice in what you have done, as people rejoice when they harvest grain or when they divide captured wealth. For you have broken the yoke that burdened them and the rod that beat their shoulders. You have defeated the nation that oppressed and exploited your people, just as you defeated the army of Midian long ago. The boots of the invading army and all their bloodstained clothing will be destroyed by fire. A child is born to us, a son is given to us, and he will be our ruler. He will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, Prince of Peace. We light again the first candle on the Advent wreath, symbolizing hope, and the second candle symbolizing peace. Today we light the third candle, symbolizing joy. May we experience anew the joy of knowing Christ, the joy of serving Christ, and the joy of sharing with Christ and the salvation that he offers us.
Amen. And now Emma and Dr. Steve will share that first verse of O Come, O Come, Emmanuel. Our first hymn today will be It Came Upon a Midnight Clear.
Glorious song of old.
as we continue to try and keep everyone safe, as we continue to live into and with these restrictions as we understand them. Some wonderful news. Pastor Jay may have been exposed, but he tested negative, but he's still within that window where they tell you to kind of shelter in place and stay at home. So he's going to appear by video again this week, but we are thankful for his negative test. We are thankful for this technology that lets us continue to hear from him. And he has a message this morning for our young believers.
I want to say hello to all of our children, those who usually would be with us in our worship services, and others that may be listening to us on Facebook or later on our YouTube channel. It's great to be with you on this day. I want to take just a moment in time on this third Sunday of Advent to talk about the word joy. You heard that being referred to as we lighted the Advent wreath candle today. It was the pink candle, which symbolizes joy. It's also an ongoing part of our sermon series. Today's sermon is entitled Rejoice Always. And both scripture passages that we will read deal with the idea of joy. But to talk about joy with the children today, I want to take us back to the Old Testament book of Nehemiah. The setting for Nehemiah is sometime after the Israelite people had reached the promised land. Remember, we journeyed throughout the book of Exodus with the Israelite people on their way to the promised land. By then, they had established homes and businesses, villages, a temple from which to worship God. And as a matter of fact, after some time in the promised land, they were taken over by their enemies. Their villages and homes were destroyed, and they were ruled by others. It was a very dark time in the lives of the Israelite people. Then in Nehemiah, the Israelite people return. They are no longer captive. They come home, though, to see that their land has been destroyed. And Nehemiah, who's moved by this, asks the king for permission to begin to rebuild once more. And he begins by rebuilding the wall around the city of Jerusalem. And later, when the wall is complete, he invites the Israelite people to come to worship, to come to hear God's law being proclaimed. Well, during this worship time, when they heard the law of God, it says in Scripture that the Israelite people wept and cried. They felt guilty for all that had happened. They knew that they had sinned, and they knew that they had turned away from God. But listen to what Nehemiah said to them. And this is the verse that I want us to remember today. Nehemiah says to them, "Do not be grieved, for the joy of the Lord is your strength." Say that with me. Do not be grieved, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. Nehemiah reminded the people that God loved them, that God wanted to continue to be their God, and that God wanted them to continue to be God's people. Nehemiah reminded the Israelite people that God would always be with them, even in all of the hard times in life. In this, the Israelite people could be joyful. In this, the Israelite people could find strength. "Do not be grieved," Nehemiah said, "for the joy of the Lord is your strength." I know you're going to find this hard to believe, but I learned a song using this verse, and I want you to hear it and learn it with me. It goes like this. The joy of the Lord is my strength. 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 He heals the brokenhearted and they cry no more. He heals the brokenhearted and they cry no more. He heals the brokenhearted and they cry no more. The joy of the Lord is my strength. He gives me living water and I thirst no more. He gives me living water and I thirst no more. He gives me living water and I thirst no more. The joy of the Lord is my strength. He fills my soul with laughter, ha, 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 ha. He fills my soul with laughter, ha, 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 ha. He fills my soul with laughter, ha, 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 ha. The joy of the Lord is my strength. 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 Remember that. The joy of the Lord is your strength too. Amen. Have a great day.
The joy of the Lord is our strength. And we find strength also in our times of prayer, whether they're individual times of personal devotion, times like Bible study or our Wednesday morning prayer group, opportunities to share our joys and concerns together in worship. We send out the email list. We send out a prayer booklet, again, at office@trucksvilleumc.com is a great way to connect with us to receive all of these updates. We're going to share a whole bunch of them today without a lot of detail. That detail lives in those emails and in those booklets. But there are so many who have been impacted by this virus, by COVID. We'd ask you to pray for Art and Pat Kerpovich, for the Wagner family, for Cortland Van Deutsch and her aunt Jill Van Bodegum Smith, for Bob and Charlotte Sestak. So many others that need prayers for a variety of reasons. Mark Umford asked us to pray for his friend, Chris B. Keep Courtney Kristen in your prayers. Charlotte Farley has asked for prayers for a friend who's facing some surgery upcoming. Keep Larry and Jen Dawes in your prayers as well. Jack and Noreen Cellerari, James and Sarah. Keep Jason Coons and James Sutton in your prayers, along with Kathy Fox. We'd ask you to keep the entire Fame family, Larry Jr., Sarah, in your prayers as they're facing some health challenges in these days. And then there are those who are grieving. We grieve, but we celebrate the life of Melba Dixon, who at 101 went home to glory this week. We give thanks for all the lives that she touched and for her reunions in heaven. The family in Plains that could use your prayers, you may have seen the news about that fire. Keep that family in your prayers. Keep the family of Rob D. in your prayers. And keep all those who are dealing with thoughts and ideas of suicide in your prayers, especially at this time, this season. Keep Joe and Tricia Gesick and family in your prayers as he recuperates, and the Stritzinger family as well. That's just part of the list that we know about. You all have so many more. We encourage you, if you're comfortable, in this Facebook post or on the YouTube video, post in the comments prayer requests that we might share with one another, we might share with the community. We also come this morning with some prayers of gratitude and thanksgiving. Denise Cardell shared an update on Jeff. He continues to improve a little bit, was able to sit up in his bed, and she was able to visit with him this week, I believe, so we're very excited for them and for him. Mary Manfrey gives thanks for her health, family's health and recovery after some COVID exposures and some other issues. We give thanks and rejoice with them for God's healing. Perhaps you have those moments of celebration and joy even in the midst of this pandemic. Maybe you have concerns and worries that you'd like to share with us. Please do that again in those comments. And I invite you now to pray with me, to come on a journey of prayer as we come before the Lord this morning. Almighty God, we have come recognizing that our joy is found in you, that the joy of the Lord is our strength. And yet, Lord, at the same time, in this wonderful, joyous season, as we face the ongoing, lingering impacts of this pandemic, as we wait for vaccines and healing, as we've entered this period of restriction again, that joy can feel fleeting at times when we look around. And Lord, that's why it's so important that we can come together through technology to worship you on our own in personal devotions in small groups, to remember, to be reminded, to share with one another who you are, what you have done, what you're doing right now, and all that you have promised to us. Lord, in this Advent season, as we look to Christmas, as we look to your coming to this world, you're making that promise of Emmanuel, God with us, a reality. Help us to remember the power you have to change lives, the power we have when we abide in you, to change not only our lives, but the lives of those we meet. And Lord, in the face of this long prayer list, in the face of this long upcoming winter of uncertainty, remind us of the hope we have in you. Lord, your scripture says that you have a future filled with hope for each of us. But then you call us to seek you with our whole heart. Lord, help us to do that. This season especially, to seek you with every bit of who we are and what we have and all we're ever going to be. That you might continue to change us and work on us. That we might find moments of hope and peace and joy and love. Not just in this season, not just in this day, but every moment of every day of every year of the rest of our lives. That we might leave behind a legacy of lives touched, a gift to you and ourselves and those lives of eternity. And Lord, we take this moment of quiet, wherever we are, however we are, wherever we find ourselves on our journey, we take this moment of quiet to be with you and to share our hearts. Lord, as we have shared these things with you, we know that you already know. We know that you're already at work. We know that you have a plan, even for the things that don't make sense to us. But Lord, we share so that we might remind ourselves one more time of who you are and who we are in you. Lord, we thank you for the depth of your love that caused you to give up your throne, to come to earth as a small baby, to live among us, to grow into a man who became a teacher and a healer, to become the servant and the sacrifice that went to that cross, laying down your life in place of ours, bridging that gap between us and God once and for all. Lord, thank you seems hardly enough. And so in this moment, in this time of prayer, we commit ourselves to living into that gift, to becoming all that you intend us to be, as individuals, as families, as a church, as a community. Lord, help us to do that this season, we pray. Lord, and as we do that, make us disciples in the truest sense of the word. Disciples, bold enough to pray along with your very first disciples, the prayer you taught them. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As we come to what would normally be our offertory time, if we were gathered together, just a simple thank you, which seems hardly enough. for all of your generosity in terms of your financial giving, certainly. And there are so many ways to give to the church to support our budget. There's a lockbox outside. You can mail offerings in. You can leave them at the office. You can use our online giving platform, Tithely, and we'll share that link at some point in this video. Multiple ways you can share in the mission and ministry of this church. But more so, thank you for your generosity with your time, your talents, your gifts. We had a delivery yesterday of most of our project PJ Pajamas, more folks coming this morning. You've continued to support Maddie's gift and the food pantry and so many other ways that I don't even know about. You have been disciples in the truest sense of the word, and we are grateful. Each month we have a mission of the month, which is another way financially that you can support in these times an important ministry. And our mission of the month is the Kirby Family House. We're taking monetary donations. There are also bins in which you can drop off some of the supplies you see on the screen. Laundry detergent and baby shampoo and regular shampoo and conditioner, deodorant, kids' underwears, soup and ramen noodles, all kinds of things that they can use to provide support to families in crisis. Like so many of our missions, as we return to a more normal mode of operation, it's our hope and prayer that in addition to these resources, we can share some of our time and talent with Kirby House, with Patriots Cove, with so many other of the wonderful missions that you continue to support so generously. So again, thank you in this season, in this time, for being who you are, the church, in so many places and in so many ways. Emma and Dr. Steve, with a little bit of help from me, are going to share some special music this morning. One frozen night in 1914, at the height of World War I, the unthinkable happened. All along the entire Western Front, the British and German soldiers lay down their weapons in an unofficial ceasefire to celebrate Christmas together. They exchanged gifts and saw each other as brothers. And that peace lasted two more days when they were ordered back to battle. In those few days, though, men remembered the true meaning of Christmas amongst the devastation. And it's a story that should never be forgotten.
Through the smoke-filled night, silence rose from both sides. Across a bloody battlefield, it was a cold Christmas Eve in 1914. For those who were there, it seemed unreal. As time was still, the spirit moved the soldiers to lay down their arms, raise their voice in song, and pretend for a while the war was over. If it could happen then, it could happen again. A war torn apart to join hands and hearts to celebrate his birth and peace on this earth. If for one magic night we could find again a reason not to fight, maybe there's a chance this time it might last. As opposing sides approached, through broken words they spoke. It wasn't long before they felt at ease. They shared their cigarettes. What they had, they used as gifts. They didn't feel like enemies. With candles lit, they stood shoulder to shoulder. And on that field they found true common ground. And as they prayed, they dreamed the war was over. If it could happen then, it could happen again. A world torn apart, to join hands and hearts to celebrate his birth and peace on this earth. If for one magic night we could find again a reason not to fight, maybe there's a chance this time it might last. If it could happen then, it could happen again. And
all God's people said amen. We're going to share two scriptures. I'm going to read one. Emma's going to read the other one. The first is from Isaiah chapter 61. This is from the Message. The Spirit of God, the Master, is on me because God anointed me. He sent me to preach good news to the poor, heal the brokenhearted, announce freedom to all captives, pardon all prisoners. God sent me to announce the year of his grace, a celebration of God's destruction of our enemies, and to comfort all who mourn, to care for the needs of all who mourn in Zion. Give them bouquets of roses instead of ashes, messages of joy instead of news of doom, a praising heart instead of a languid spirit. Rename them oaks of righteousness, planted by God to display his glory. They'll rebuild the old ruins, raise a new city out of the wreckage. They'll start over in the ruined cities, take the rubble left behind and make it new. I will sing for joy in God, explode in praise from deep in my soul. He dressed me up in a suit of salvation. He outfitted me in a robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom who puts on a tuxedo and a bride in a jeweled tiara. For as the earth bursts with spring wildflowers, and as a garden cascades with blossoms, so the Master God brings righteousness into full bloom and puts praise on display before the nations.
And I'll be reading from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 16 through 24. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Do not quench the Spirit, do not despise the words of prophets, but test everything. Hold fast to what is good. Abstain from every form of evil. May the God of peace himself sanctify you entirely, and may your spirit and soul and body be kept sound and blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do this.
Will you pause with me for a moment of prayer? Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of each of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. I want to take a moment just to thank Ian and Dr. Steve and all others who are helping with today's worship service. The definition of emotions from the Oxford Dictionary is as follows: a natural instinctive state of mind deriving from one's circumstances, mood, or relationship with others. Again, that's the definition of emotions. The watered-down J. Jones version of that definition is this: a reaction or feeling in response to something or in response to someone. And the key here is in response to. There are many common emotions, and I want to share just a few and how and why we might experience these emotions. I'll begin with the emotion fear. Maybe we were alone at home one evening and we heard an unidentified noise outside. Our natural response or emotion might be fear. Or how about anger? Maybe we found out that a friend was saying some negative things about us to others. Our natural response or emotion might be anger. Or how about sadness? And this truly is a reality this season. Maybe one of our most sacred traditions, Christmas Eve with family, for dinner first, followed by worship at Trucksville Church. Maybe one of our most sacred traditions will not happen the way it has in the past. And our response, our emotion, is that of sadness. We feel that this year. Or how about the emotion happiness? And this did occur to me this past week. Maybe we placed an order at one of the local restaurant's drive-throughs, only to find out that the people in the car in front of us had already paid for our meal. Our response, our emotion, happiness. Again, these are common emotions that are dependent upon our circumstances, dependent upon what is going on in our lives, or dependent upon something that just happened to us. Usually these emotions are temporary. After some time, they tend to fade. But then there's joy. Joy is quite a bit different from these emotions. Joy is not dependent upon what happens in our lives, and joy is not temporary. Joy is more permanent and lasts. It's usually a sign of a deeper relationship with our God. And that's what our focus is today, joy. Each of today's scripture passages emphasize the word joy or rejoice. Now, interestingly enough, the prophet Isaiah prophesied in a time of exile, hardly a time when one would think of joy. In exile, the people were away from their homeland. Nothing was familiar. They were under foreign rule. They had little control over what happened around them. And yet, the prophet shared that he was called by God to bring to God's people messages of joy instead of news of doom, a praising heart instead of a languid spirit. And then he adds my favorite line in this passage, verse 10. Isaiah says, "I will sing for joy in God, explode in praise from deep in my soul." Explode in praise from deep in my soul. I chose to use the Message translation today for the book of Isaiah because of that line that I just shared. It reminded me so much of a line that Reverend Chuck Gomer used at our lectionary study group this past week. Chuck said, "Joy oozes up from something deep inside of you. Joy oozes up from something deep inside of you." And that's exactly what the prophet said. I will sing for joy in God, explode in praise from deep within my soul. You see, that's not emotions. That's something much deeper, much more permanent, much more dependent upon our relationship with God rather than dependent upon the circumstances around us. And this is the prophet's message: to find hope, joy in the words and promises of God, even in the midst of trouble, chaos, and challenges. The prophet is able to rejoice because of his relationship with God and in spite of the circumstances in his world. And that brings us to the passage from 1 Thessalonians, which I find to be the more difficult to embrace, especially when compared to Isaiah. Paul says in 1 Thessalonians that we are to rejoice always, to give thanks in all circumstances. Always, all circumstances. There are many circumstances in life where rejoicing and giving thanks is difficult. Over my 32 plus years in ministry, I've been with numerous individuals and or families who have faced tragic and difficult situations. Almost nothing is worse than the unexpected death of a loved one. This is not a passage that I would probably read in the midst of acute grief or extreme pain. Why? Because we lack perspective to give thanks in all circumstances. It's nearly impossible to do this when we are in the midst of grief and pain. Now, I want to go on record as saying that it is okay to grieve, to mourn, to be angry, to have doubts, to raise questions. All of these things are part of the journey. But as we do that, we need also to heed Paul's other words of advice from Thessalonians, when he uses this phrase, to pray without ceasing, to turn to God, to talk with God, to pray to God, even if our prayers are filled with questions, with anger, and with grief. These times of acute grief are the times when we most need to lean on God. We need to trust God and trust God's presence during these difficult times. And when we do, we will discover that the certainty of a deep and abiding relationship with God will provide us with the strength we need to carry on. Remember Nehemiah? Do not be grieved, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. I like what the theologian Henry Nouwen said about joy. Nouwen said, "Joy is the experience that you are unconditionally loved and that nothing, sickness, failure, emotional distress, oppression, war, or even death can take that love away. The joy of the Lord is my strength." Amen. I want to take just a moment and say a word about a service of the longest night. December 21st is what is known as the winter solstice. It is the longest night of the year. We gather in the peak of this darkness experience for a worship service, a service that may speak to any one of us. In this time of worship, we will acknowledge grief, pain, loss, and disappointment. We will affirm the difficulty this time of year brings. When others gather for a time of merry and mirth, and we just aren't feeling it. It will be a service of reflection and prayer. And we end the worship service with words of hope, even in the midst of the darkness. The symbolism of the service being on the longest night of the year is that the daylight begins to grow with the very next morning. This is the light that Jesus brings in our lives. The service itself will be a Zoom worship service. We will send out a link, and it begins at 6 p.m. on the 21st. It will be very informal, but very interactive. Join us and share with others too that you think may benefit from sharing in this worship experience. God bless you and have a great day.
As we come to the end of this worship time, I want to challenge you to do something. Our final hymn, Emma and Dr. Steve are going to lead it, is Joy to the World. Wherever you are in this moment, as you're watching this video, if you're able, I want you to stand up. One of the things we complained about a lot when we were able to gather in person is that we couldn't sing. I want you to sing this like you've never sung it before. I want your neighbors to hear you sing this. Joy to the World.
Truth and grace, and makes the nation.
One of the greatest wonders of his love is that he loves me and that he loves you. So where do we find that joy? We find it in the last verse of the passage from 1 Thessalonians. The reason we can be joyful regardless of our circumstances is verse 24. Because the one who calls you is faithful, and he will do this. We love and serve a God who is faithful and will do this. Whatever this is for you, I don't know what you are in the midst of. Sometimes I barely know what I'm in the midst of. But whatever it is that you need, our God will do this. Reflect on those words as Dr. Steve shares our prelude, as you go about your day today, as you go about your week, till we can gather together separately again to worship Almighty God. Go knowing that that God who is faithful loves you more than you will ever know. That there's nothing you can do to make God love you more. There's nothing you can do that will make God love you less. There's nothing you can do about it except go to love and serve in his name. Amen.